Today I'm going to show you the differences between these two cameras, the A7C and the A7 III. When the A7 III came out, the tagline was basic model, or something to that extent, but the specs were far from basic and it really did feel like a pro level camera, to a certain extent. But when the A7C came out, it was a little bit underwhelming, especially with the A7S just being released and the A7R IV released a while back earlier in the year. It just seems like a bit of a revamp of an old camera, a bit like when Canon went from the 5D Mark III to the 5D Mark IV. Now, some of you might be wondering why I went for the A7C over the A7 III. Today I'm going to go through all of those differences between these two cameras and ultimately show you why I went for this over the A7 III. Now on the surface, it looks like they've just taken the A7 III internals and then put them into a smaller body, but there's a bit more to it than that. Even though they said the price is $200 cheaper, you can find A7 IIIs out there on offer at the same price, so I'd ignore the price difference. If you look hard enough, you can find good deals out there. The sensor is the same size and therefore the image quality will be pretty much the same. Now straight away looking at the cameras, you can see that they've got rid of the front dial just below the shutter button. I don't know why they've done this, because if you're a manual still shooter and like to have a dial for your aperture, your shutter speed and ISO, you don't have all three dials. You only have the two dials on the back, whereas with the A7 III, you have those three dials. Now they both have exposure compensation dials, and it would have been great if they'd have made this a customizable dial, because then that would have solved this problem. The size is different, but in reality it only has a smaller grip and it's missing the top viewfinder, so it really isn't that much smaller. Where it does differ, however, is in the weight. The A7 III is 636 grams, whereas the A7C is 505 grams. That might seem just like a small difference, but when you've been hiking for hours, it does make a lot of difference. The viewfinder is basically the same, just with less magnification and in a different place. So it appears smaller in the A7C when you do look through the EVF. For me, it does the job adequately, although in bright sunshine, it might be a bit of a pain because there's less shading and you don't have that rubberized bit around that viewfinder. Now, some love it and some hate it, but they've introduced a flippy screen. And even though this might seem like a video thing and especially a vlogging thing, it is actually good for stills. If you shoot from up high or from down low in the portrait orientation, you can flip the screen out and see exactly what you are shooting. Whereas with the A7 III, you're basically shooting blind. That is, unless you're a 7'6" basketball player, or you don't mind sliding your face along the floor. I imagine a little bit like Smeagol would in his own little cave. But anyway, that's another thing. Now, as we all know, the A7 III has two card slots, whereas the A7C only has one. And it's on the same side as the cable ports, which does seem a little bit weird, and it took me a while to get used to. The A7 III has 7 customizable buttons in total. That's not including the dial on the back or some of those lenses with the customizable button on them, whereas the A7C has 3 customizable buttons. I've heard some people say there's only one, but there are actually 3 that you can customize, but I'll get into that a little bit later, as it does have a little bit of a caveat. So that's a big difference and really changes the way you operate the camera. But I suppose, like any camera, if it's your only one, you'll get used to it the more you use it. As for focusing, the A7 III already had a great focusing system, but the A7C has had an upgrade to this, with real-time tracking as well as video eye autofocusing and object tracking. It's basically just better in the A7C, and it seems to stick like glue to the point you select to track. The A7 III is limited to 29.59 minutes, whereas the A7C has unlimited recording for video. The IBIS is a little bit worse in the A7C, but if you're shooting video, you do have the gyro data to stabilize in post with Catalyst Browse with the A7C, which is a free bit of software, and it actually works really well. You just need a computer that is fast enough to process your videos quickly. If you buy a body with a kit lens, the A7C comes with a 28-60mm short stubby lens, whereas the A7 III comes with a very standard looking 28-70mm. Even though the A7C kit lens has a shorter focal length, it is a better lens when it comes to image quality. But I'd recommend upgrading to either the Sigma 24-70mm or the Tamron 28-75mm f2.8. They're both fantastic upgrades to the kit lens, and if you can afford it, buy just the body and one of these lenses straight away, and you'll save yourself some money in the long run. If you own the a7 III, you already know how annoying the dangly, flappy port covers are. But on the a7 C, they now have port covers similar to the battery cover. They're solid and they're hinged. The dial on the back of the a7 III is more prominent, so it's easier to turn than the a7 C. On the a7 C, it's flush with the back and it's a little bit harder. So it would have been good if they brought this out again, like on the back of the a7 III. One of the other things that I haven't seen mentioned too much is that they've got rid of the multi-port. This is a little bit annoying because all of my remotes for all of my Sony cameras use that multi-port. So I've got some, like this one here, that I can start recording or I can take a picture. I have others that are wireless but have a unit on the top. So I have a lot of remotes and a lot of things to control the camera that I can no longer use with the a7 C. So this is a little bit annoying. I did go out and buy a Bluetooth remote, but this kind of forced me to go and do that. When it comes to menus, they both have the same menu. This is great for me because I don't have to learn a new menu system, or I don't have to switch between the two. It would have been good to see in the a7 C that brand new menu that's in the a7 S III. But I suppose this is due to the brains in the camera being very similar to the a7 III and not the a7 S III. The a7 C has three custom modes on that top dial, whereas the a7 III only has two. And also, while we're on the subject of that mode dial, on the a7 C, the movie and manual modes are right next to each other. So if you are a hybrid shooter, this is just another nice little tweak. And it does actually make quite a bit of difference. Now, if you're a videographer and you film a lot of talking heads or you do a lot of talking to camera, when you do have an external monitor attached, the a7 III will switch off eye autofocus, whereas with the a7 C, it'll keep it on. So it will track that eye. Now, these are all the obvious differences between the two, but in delving a little bit deeper, I found a few more. The a7 C has a fastest shutter speed of 1/4000th of a second, whereas the a7 III shoots up to 1/8000th of a second. However, in silent mode, the a7 C will shoot up to 1/8000th of a second. In saying that, the rolling shutter is about the same, so that's something to be aware of if you are a silent shooter. For dedicated silent shooters, the best option is still the A9 series of cameras. With the a7 III, if you want to switch between NTSC and PAL, you'll have to format the card or have a card for each of those settings. With the a7 C, there's no need to do this anymore. You can switch between the two and record in the two different frequencies without formatting the card. You just won't be able to look at the preview images from the other frequency if you have switched, but it will still be there and it will be in the same folder in sequential order. It also doesn't put up that annoying message saying that you are shooting in NTSC every time you turn it on like in the a7 III. Although if you're on the latest firmware, which is I think 3.10, I think they've gotten rid of this now. But if you are on one of the older firmwares, when you're shooting in NTSC, whenever you turn it on, it will tell you that you're shooting in that mode for some reason. The a7 C has more aspect ratios. 4x3 and 1x1 has been added to the 3x2 and 16x9 that's already in the a7 III. Although these are superficial, as you can always go back to the original image in Lightroom when shooting stills. In going through the menus, even though they both look the same, there are a few additions to the a7 C. The a7 C has focus area limit. This means if you only use one or two focus areas, you can select only the ones that you use. So you won't always have to scroll through a whole list of different focusing areas, just the ones that you want. I use wide or flexible spot medium or large, so I've removed all of the others, and it's great to have this option. I just wish they'd add it to other menu lists like the profiles and like the white balance settings. The white balance settings in the a7 III and in the a7 C is huge. You have so many different ones, from white balancing underwater with a fish to custom menus and things like that. It would be really good if we could customize all of the menus like this. So maybe that's something that they're going to do in the future. I just wish they'd have done it with all of the menus straight away instead of just one of them. Another setting I found in the A7 III is aperture drive in autofocus. So if you're shooting in silent mode, this gives you the option to be even quieter, but it does slow down the focusing speed a little bit. I only really see the need for this if you were to shoot a funeral or in a library, but both of those would be a little bit weird. You can also now change the focusing box frame color, so no more gray focusing squares that blend into the background. In fact, I don't know why they haven't done this in a firmware upgrade in the A7 III. This is so annoying, as that gray focusing square in the A7 III disappears all of the time. You almost have to wave it to the bright parts to kind of find it. But it's great that they've got this option in the A7C, and you can choose between a white focusing square or a red focusing square. Another setting I found in the A7C is circulation of focus point. This means if you get to the edge with your flexible focusing square, it will jump to the other side if you keep pressing the D-pad in that same direction. It's a little bit like the old game Snake on the Nokia 3310. Now, if you're fairly young, that probably won't mean anything to you, but there was this game called Snake where you'd take the snake off the screen and then it would carry on coming on the other side. It just does that with your focusing square. If we keep going through the menus, there's another one called Autofocus Frame Move AMT. This is where you can set the amount of distance covered with each press of the D button on the back of the camera when it comes to moving your flexible focus area. This just means that box will get across the back of your screen a lot quicker, but it'll be a little bit less precise. However, if you're used to using the focus touch function, you won't really need this. Another one I've found is shutter auto white balance lock. If you're shooting in auto white balance, this will lock it at different stages through your shooting process, depending on which one you choose in this menu setting. You either have off, continuous shooting, or halfway press. So the white balance won't change through a sequence of shots if you have it on continuous, or if you've half pressed that shutter button. Or you can turn this off so it just continuously auto white balances the scene. Then you have two settings for video, which are autofocus transition speed and autofocus subject shift sensitivity. This is to do with how responsive the focus is and how well it'll track and lock onto your subject. This is more to do with shooting video, but it's great to see that they're updating these focus systems with every new camera that they bring out. In the A7 III, you can turn off E front curtain shutter, so it's all mechanical. But in the A7C, they've got rid of this in the menus, so E front curtain will always be on. By the sounds of it, it does sound like a different shutter mechanism. So for all those people that have had problems with the A7 III shutter mechanism, I think they've upgraded it and they've made it hopefully a bit more sturdy and a bit more robust. However, only time will tell if this is actually the case. With Finder Frame Rate, this is where you can increase the frame rate of your viewfinder. Apparently it makes it easier to look through, although I didn't really notice that much of a difference. When you're setting up your custom buttons in the custom menus, this gives you pictures of where the buttons are on the camera, whereas in the A7 III, it's just a list. So this is a bit like the Canon system when you're customizing your Canon camera. Also, you can customize the movie button in the A7C. So in reality, this is that third customizable button that I was talking about earlier. So if you take the rubbish bin as your C1, you then have the AF on button as the second custom button, and then the movie button as the third custom button. Now, if you do keep your camera in the stills mode and then use that movie button to start filming video, so if you're a hybrid shooter in that sense, you won't be able to customize this button. However, if you shoot stills in all of the stills modes, and then you switch over to the movie mode on that top dial, you can then select the shutter button to start filming movies. So in that respect, you could use it as a third customizable button. Now, this all comes down to how you shoot and how you use the camera. I always switch to the movie mode, so that movie button will actually be my third customizable button. The FN menu set lets you have two different menus in the A7C, one for stills and one for video, whereas in the A7 III, it only has one for both. And when you're setting this up, it lays it out in the menu as it would do in the actual FN menu screen, so you can see where things are, whereas in the A7 III, again, it's just those lists. With the touchscreens, they're both very similar and quite basic. However, in the A7C, there's a new setting called Function of Touch Operation. This means when you touch the back screen, you can either take a photo once focused, you can just move the focus square, or you can activate the focus tracking. Then if we go deeper into the menus, we can start writing the serial number of the camera if we want to in the EXIF data. You can either turn this on or off. After using the A7C for a while, I did notice a few other differences. The shutter button does feel a little different. On the A7 III, it is a little bit more spongy, whereas when you do a full press on the A7C, it feels like it clicks. It almost feels like a digital button over an analog button. Another thing that I noticed was that Sony seemed to be developing that color science in small increments. In the A7C, the shadows are slightly greener in certain profiles, whereas in the A7 III, it's a little bit more magenta and a little bit more muddy. Now, this is good as we're getting better colors as time goes by, but a little bit bad if you want to match videos from different cameras. Now, I was also able to fit an old screen protector that I had in my drawer for my A7 III. I think I bought a pack of 3 or 4 of them, so I had some spares. I tried to put this on the back of the A7C and it did fit. So it just about is the same physical size as well as having the same internal components in that back screen. Now, after going through all of that, there are a few things that I really don't like about the A7C. Having no front wheel just under the shutter button is really annoying. I do shoot a lot in manual mode, so this means I have to change my aperture with the dial on the top. I then have to change my shutter speed with a dial on the back, and then I have to keep that D button right for my ISO. So it's kind of taking away that kind of custom button that I'd normally have in that button on the back. With the doors, they have to be shut and then locked. It would have been much better if these were to auto lock. So when you shut them, the locking mechanism almost springs back into place. But I suppose they're using the same mechanism as the battery door. Now the grip does feel a lot smaller with the A7C. Even the A6600 has a much bigger grip compared to this. It's not a worry if you have small hands, but with my big sausage fingers, it's really annoying. No company makes an L bracket yet, but once we do have an L bracket, this will be a little bit of a help because it'll give somewhere for the little finger to sit. But it did feel a little bit less bulky and less to hold onto. Now, there are a few things that I do really like on the A7C, and one of them is that flippy screen. It's fantastic for both video and stills, and I do really like using them. I know this is a little bit like Marmite or Vegemite for those Antipodeans that are watching, but you kind of either love it or you hate it. And it does really get people commenting and it does rile people up a lot. But I really like using the flippy screen. And if I'm shooting in portrait mode and I'm holding the camera low down, it's great to be able to open that flippy screen up and be able to see what you're shooting. Even though there are less customizable buttons, I didn't notice this too much after I got used to the layout that I set it up with. Like with any camera, you adapt to it and get used to it the more you use it. Now, if you're a manual shooter and you just need 3 dials for your primary settings and are so used to that setup, I'd say get the A7 III. If you use the semi-auto modes most of the time, the A7C might be a little bit better, especially if you want a small and light camera. For video, even though they are both great cameras, the A7C has a few upgrades that really make it a worthwhile investment. And if you have a fast enough computer, the post-stabilization from the gyro data is fantastic. And if you're on a budget and can't quite afford either, maybe a secondhand A7 III would be the best bet if you can find a good deal. They have been out for a while, so there are quite a few on the secondhand market, so you should be able to find a good deal if you look hard enough. Now, what do you think? Have you got the A7 III already, or are you looking to upgrade to a full frame sensored camera? If so, let me know in the comments below. It'll be great to hear your thoughts. And I have links to these cameras in the description if you are interested in either. Also, if you like this video, click on this one next. And if you'd like to learn more about photography, click down here. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe for weekly videos and tutorials in photography and videography. I'll see you next time.